So let's suppose that observe that UH at x equals xe, all right, is basically UH at x evaluated with c equals minus 1, right? It's the left end of the element, right? It's the left hand side node, which in the omega c space is represented by c equals minus 1, right? So this then is sum over a n a evaluated at c 1, right? Because remember, c 1 in the omega c space is what we identified as being equal to minus 1, right? So it's n a evaluated at c 1 d a e. Okay, but then we recall that this that these basis functions we've constructed have this Kronecker delta property, right? So this is essentially the Kronecker delta delta a 1. Okay. Okay, and therefore apply to d a e, this becomes equal to simply d 1 e. Okay? Right? Essentially, what we've done here is to observe that if we want to evaluate the trial solution at the left node, right, it's effectively the first node of this element, what we get is that the trial solution is indeed equal to the degree of freedom corresponding to that node. And the same thing happens if we want to evaluate UH at xe plus 1. This is equal to UH at x with c equal to 1, okay? This is equal to sum over a n a c2, recognizing that c2 is the point c equals 1, times d a e, okay? But then this again becomes delta a 2 by the Kronecker delta property of the basis functions. And therefore this, when applied to d a e, gives us d 2 e, okay? All right. Essentially, the Kronecker delta property ensures for us that the trial solution evaluated at the corresponding node is indeed the degree of freedom value at the node. Okay. Stated differently, the nodal degrees of freedom are indeed the trial solutions themselves using these particular basis functions. Okay. So, and the same thing, by the way, happens, of course, for WH as well. I won't go through the details, but WH evaluated at XE is equal to C1E, and WH evaluated at XE plus 1 equals C2E. Okay? So the remark here is that the Kronecker delta property the Kronecker delta property of the basis functions and by this we mean the specific basis functions that we're working with, right? The Kronecker delta property of the basis functions ensures that the nodal degrees of freedom, right, which are these ones, right, or these for the weighting function, right, this ensures that the nodal degrees of freedom of the solution field are indeed its values at the nodes. Okay? This is sometimes referred to as the interpolatory property of these basis functions. It is not a universal property of arbitrary basis functions. We have specifically chosen basis functions that give us this property. All right? Okay, why did I need to say all of this? I needed to say all of this because it is what we are using here. Okay? We're using it in particular in this, to make this identification of WH at L being equal to C2 for element NEL. Okay? All right. So we have this. Okay? And this is the reason we're able to do that. Okay? Fine. What we want to do here now is go back to what we had when we put together the finite dimensional weak form, when we made all these observations about how it can be written out in terms of the matrix vector products. Okay, you have it on your notes, and thanks to the technology here, I have it in front of me, and you can't quite see it, but I can see that I have it here. Okay, so what I want you to do is go back to your notes to the point just before we made the slight digression to talk about this Kronecker delta property of the basis functions. Okay? Go back to how we'd written out the weak form, okay? And we are going to work off there, okay? All right. So if you look at the way I've written out the finite dimensional weak form just preceding this this remark, you will see that we are now able to pull things together from there, okay? And in order to pull things together, what we need to do is to observe that there is a mapping between the degrees of freedom as expressed using local node numbers and global node numbers, okay? So note that the following map holds between local and global node numbers or local and global degrees of freedom. Okay. I will express this map first in terms of the degrees of freedom that are used to interpolate the trial solution. Okay. So, if we have this particular local degree of freedom, and recall that this refers to local degree of freedom A in element E. Okay. This can be written as global degree of freedom, D, E, plus 1, okay? Let me see. So D, E, plus 1, sorry, it's not D, E, plus 1, it should be D, E, plus A minus 1. Okay? So this, let me write out in words what this means. On the left-hand side, I have local degree of freedom A in element number E. Okay? That's what this refers to. On the right-hand side, I have global global degree of freedom number E, E plus A minus 1. Okay? Let's check that it works. It's always a useful thing to do, right? So let's just check right here. Okay, so let's suppose we're an element 1 and we're talking of the first degree of freedom. Okay, that would be D1, 1. That is the same on the right hand side for the global degrees of freedom. D E is equal to 1, A equals 1, so we get D1. Okay, likewise, D2, 1 is equal to D. E equals 1, A equals 2 minus 1, D2. Okay, and this goes on. Let's check what happens in the very last element, right? So when we have D1, NEL, this is equal to, now E equals NEL, A equals 1, so we get DNEL, and D2NEL is equal to global degree of freedom, E equals NEL, A equals 2, we get DNEL plus 1. Okay, this works out because if we look at our domain, right, and this is the very first element, right, this is omega 1, right, I will write up here the local degrees of freedom. Right, the global degrees of freedom for this are D1 and D2. Okay, for the very last element, which is this one, right, this is omega NEL. The local degrees of freedom here are D1 NEL and D2 NEL, and here we have D. NEL, DNEL plus 1, right? Makes sense. We have one node more than the numbers of elements, right? The total number of nodes is one more than the number of elements. And that is borne out by the way things work out here. Okay? All right. And of course, the same thing holds for the other ones also. Right, similarly we have C A E equals C E plus A minus 1. All right, so we made this made the observation about this mapping between local and global degrees of freedom. We will use this to go back to that weak form that we had written out in terms of matrix and vector products over each element and carry out an important process of finite element assembly. We should probably do this in the next segment though. Okay? So we'll come back to this in just a little bit.